So the first thing I was struck by was how much I liked the how sinister the logo treatment is, being in black and white, that the clouds almost looks like King Kong or something. It was, and is that, I guess it's just the luck of it being in black and white or being duped? Or?
I think it was just the luck of the draw there. Yeah. I know that we wanted it in black and white, and that's the way it came out. It was really nice.
It's nice also to have the producer of the film be running the studio so that he can make those kinds of decisions to say, let them do what they want to the logo.
Yes, yes. He was actually very good on this.
Yeah. I love this title treatment. I love the artwork of it. I just love the style of it. When was the first time you saw it? At the premiere, or had you seen
No,
it?
The first time I really saw it was at a screening of the film for Variety and Reporter at the old Directors Guild building. And up to that point, I, like most of us, thought the film was a disaster. I just thought, this is never going to work. I don't know if now's an appropriate time to get into the problem with the score.
Well, one of the things I wanted to ask you, and you don't have to divulge this, but who did the original score that was...
I can't remember his name. And the only reason why we don't have that score was that Roman was going off to Spoleto to direct an opera.
Right.
And left us behind.
Goldsmith, you know, obviously has a body of great work, but I think this is the pinnacle. I look at this and I say, I mean, I know it was done in 9 days and I know it was a pinch hit, but man, it is as close to the designated hitter hitting a home run as you can.
Interestingly enough, it was Evans who suggested the trumpet as a leitmotif.
Well, and the trumpet is, it's one of those things that you would think, you know, it would be too strident in some kind of way. It would be too, but it's so mournful. It has such a wonderfully kind of lonely quality.
Yeah, it's a soft kind of sound, yeah. And the brass part of it is minimized.
All right, Curly, enough's enough. You can't eat the Venetian blinds. I just had them installed on Wednesday. Ooh. Down the hatch.
Just no good.
What can I tell you, kid? You're right. When you're right, you're right. You're right.
I get a rest next week. You only caught 60 tons of skipjack on San Benedict. And they don't pay you the same for skipjack as they do albacore.
Forget it, will you, Curly? I only brought it up to illustrate a point. I don't want your last dime. What kind of a guy do you think I am?
Thank you, Mr. Gittes.
Call me Jake. Careful driving home, Curl, huh?
My first comment on this is, you know, how great is Burt Young? And the whole cast, I mean, we'll get into this a little bit later, but the entire cast in terms of where they are, I mean, because a lot of these guys went on to do television, and a lot of these guys, you know, did a lot of television. Not everyone became Jack Nicholson after this, but they're all, you know, when something works, it works. It's so hand in glove through every face, just Bruce Glover in the background there chewing his gum, and it's so perfectly realized. Is how much does luck play in that, do you think?
There was a tremendous amount of luck in dealing with this movie. There was great luck in having Roman direct the movie, because at first he wasn't, I don't know that he was that interested, but he decided to do it. And frankly, there was great luck that he left for Spoleto when he did, because everybody, no matter how good they are, and this movie would not work as well with any other director,
yeah,
if at all.
Forget everything.
But
I'm sure that he loves you too, Mrs. Mulray. Do you know the expression, let sleeping dogs lie?
At critical junctures, people made their entrances and exits in just the right way.
Very well.
What is your husband's first name?
Hollis. Hollis Mulray.
Water and power?
One of the things that I'm curious about in this, so Diane Ladd later on is going to say, first of all, I love the name Ida Sessions. I just love the idea, especially because you're going to see that she has a SAG card later on. And there's something about the name Sessions that just feels like voiceover talent or something.
Right.
There's something that, was that an intent? I mean, what was Sessions? Was just a name you picked out of?
All the names I picked out of the past, mm-hmm. and I don't remember where, but I was reading obscure tomes like the history of the Bench and Bar in Southern California in 1905. Mm-hmm. And some of the names of the judges in that book were names that had disappeared in the 20th century, but they were there, and I picked them out because I liked the sound. And it just seemed like the right kind of sound.
But we also live on the edge of a desert. Los Angeles is a desert community. Beneath this building, beneath our street.
I love the way that Gittes is always reading the paper. It makes him sort of kind of, he's cognizant of the world around him. He's, you know, he seems to have so many sort of facts and things at his fingertips. For instance, there's this thing that I would think would be impossible to get away with at the beginning where Ida Sessions says to him, my husband is Hollis Mulray, and Gittes says, water and power. You kind of go.
Mayor Bagley, Chief Mulray Department.
How many people know
that? Yeah.
Who knows who runs water and power today? I mean, you could hold people at gunpoint and probably. But there's this wonderful little flourish right there where the paper sort of collapses as they say Hollis Mulray, and he looks up to get a look at Mulray for the first time. Was that something that was indicated in the text?
I honestly don't remember if there was, but the one thing I would say about water and power is at that particular juncture, water was much more on the minds of everyone in Los Angeles.
Wow.
And Mulray, like the name William Mulholland, would be somebody that people would know.
I see. Wouldn't Mulholland be the equivalent of Noah Cross?
No, actually, Mulray and Mulholland, they were the what was known in those days as a sanjero, from the old Spanish term, water carrier.
Right.
And he was the builder. Cross was the owner. It would be analogous to producer-director.
I see. There's a lovely moment here with Rance Howard.
Yes.
Who looks so much, Ron looks so much like him right now.
He does, doesn't he?
Starve my livestock! Who's paying you to do that, Mr. Mulray? That's what I want to know!
One of the things that I love is this notion of a mystery where your protagonist is following someone who's in the middle of their own mystery. So that his behavior is made, the behavior that the watcher is watching is made all the more peculiar because it's that person is also trying to figure out what it is that's going on. So when we see this amazing silhouette of Hollis Mulray and how sort of frail and period he is, and yet there's this mystery that he's actually traipsing through when he goes over and talks to the boy on the sway-backed horse, which is an amazing image. Was that in the text, the sway-backed horse?
Yes.
Well,
it was in the text. And it was an attempt to remind everyone that L.A. was still making the transition from a rural agrarian place to a city. And within the city, you know, just like chickens in the backyard, you had remnants of a past that was quickly fading away.
The Camino Real.
Right.
And again, his, you know, this wonderful prop. You see this throughout the movie, these beautiful props, this book that he has. So we're wondering, why is this strange, skinny, bird-like man? He's writing all this stuff down, and later on we'll see it, and of course we're reminded of it because of the peculiarity of his behavior with it.
I think that one of the advantages of creating the water as the mystery it really gives you something to follow that's right in front of your face, but not exactly something that makes any sense to you
right.
until it does, until you realize.
Until he puts it together.
Yeah.
There's that little hamburger stand. I was scouting a commercial once, and I remember driving up, and that park is still there. And I remember stopping and saying, oh, my goodness, that's the hamburger. This street is from Chinatown. And we went to, and I was so happy that I was able to remember the hamburger stand. And I went in because I wanted to have a hamburger from the hamburger stand that was in Chinatown. And I thought, you know, I'm the only one who knows this. And the walls are literally covered with clippings saying, Chinatown was filmed here. They have blow-ups of frame blow-ups of the movie. And
I had no idea.
Yeah.
I remember, it's actually San Pedro and it's Point Furman.
Yeah, yeah.
I remember that place from my childhood when I was 5 or 6. It was Mrs. Walker's, and she was alive until way into the 80s or 90s. It's now a kind of a biker place.
Yes.
But it was absolutely unchanged from the 40s at the time that we shot there.
I've asked you this before, but I think it's good to finally put it to rest, which is somebody once pointed out to me something about this movie, the visual motif of this movie, and how unbelievably relentless and perfectly formulated the visual motif, which is, and you've told me that you were unaware of it, but the notion that throughout the movie there's a running gag of two objects that are similar, and one of which is flawed. And it begins with the watches here, and the watches get wound and they get left under the tire, and one of them gets crushed. And later on, the glasses that are going to be found in the saltwater tide pool, one of them is broken. And the sunglasses that Nicholson wears out in the orange groves when he gets hit, and one of them lenses breaks. When he follows Evelyn, he goes out and he breaks one of the taillights. It can't even take it as far as the nostril that gets slit, and the imperfection in Faye Dunaway's eye, even through to the sister-daughter that you have these two. And was that at all discussed ever?
No. It was never discussed. And I was as surprised, I guess, as anybody when it was pointed out to me. But it was operating. I was dimly aware when I used the flaw in the iris that there was some leitmotif going on, but I didn't really pay that much attention to it.
It's so funny because it is one of those things where, especially when a movie achieves the kind of status that this movie has in terms of, you know, its value to film students, you know, there are people heap meaning onto pictures and so it becomes one of those things where when it was first told to me, I thought that is the most brilliant thing I've ever heard. And the fact that the creators of this film could have kept that front and center, and that was part of the way they stitched the whole thing together. And I'm so glad that when I finally brought it up to you, you rolled your eyes and laughed.
Yeah, no, it was operating at a level of which I was unaware. And I don't think Roman was either.
What about? Well, I don't know. The traffic was pretty loud. I heard only one thing, though. Apple core.
Apple core?
Yeah.
I want to go back a little bit to the notion the first time that we meet Diane Ladd and when she's playing Evelyn Mulray. And there's a very, very interesting thing going on there because she's... As an actor, she's playing imperious. She's playing this thing. And the credit that I think you have to give to Faye Dunaway is by the time she appears in the movie, and she is Evelyn Mulray, the thing that allows you to understand that you've seen a simulation early on and you're now seeing the real thing is so much a part of the marrow of that performance, which is, Faye Dunaway never plays imperious. She just plays somebody who's used to dealing with people in a way that she's used to. There's no affect. There's no indication that she's that she comes from wealth or that she's used to bossing people around or whatever. She just, you know, you give her one of the great lines of all time: "I don't get tough with people; my lawyer does."
She's a, I guess, what you would call a California Yankee, and that is an unaffected aristocrat.
Here. Interesting.
Probably grew up as a tomboy and hung out until that horrible event in her life that I think made her very careful and cautious about everything that went on. But there should be nothing imperious in her manner, and there isn't, and I think that's right.
There's so many great choices. I mean, we talked a little bit about the notion of a cast that is just sort of waiting, the nexus, you know, that the movie, that a truly great movie is a group of people all sort of crossing over and achieving their potential at exactly the right 3-month period in order for it to be sort of recorded and for it to exist forever. And I have to comment for a second that this, to me, is the defining Jack Nicholson role. And it may have to do with how well you knew him and how much of him you were able to bring into it. But it seems to me that, especially like in this scene, one of the things that I love so much is, I mean, you're going to give him this, his whole little rant after he gets pissed off is so illuminating for the character in terms of his code. He will stoop to he'll stoop to a lot, but the notion that he's in some way abused this woman or abused this situation, and the photographs of the love nest have gotten out, and this guy is making this comment about who he is and the where he gets angry here, picks the fight with him or is willing to settle it in a fight, and then as he returns to his chair and he says, "I didn't even know how quickly that thing got into the papers," you see his kind of helplessness in this weird way. And it actually informs, you know, Garrett Breedlove a little bit. It informs R.P. McMurphy in a little bit. There's something about Nicholson that allows, he's, at the same time, he's doing this stuff which is a little bit ethically or morally compromised, he still has this very, very specific idea of who he is and what he will not do. And to me, this is what makes it the defining Jack Nicholson role. Does that make sense?
It makes complete sense. Jack's capacity for indignation is something that of which I was well aware. I when he was a starving actor, and we all were having a hard time making any kind of ends meet. We were having coffee one day at a place called Poopy's and on the Strip, and Mrs. Poopy got mad at him for only having coffee. Well, he took the napkin holder and threw it into her case of goodies, and then he said...
Her Poopy case.
Her Poopy case, and he said, "Yeah, one more word out of you and I'll kick your pastry tray in." And it was that you could not resist tapping into.
You know, you see it throughout. I mean, you can see it later on when Escobar, when he has his dress down with Escobar at Ida Sessions' house, and he's like, "That's, you know, I wouldn't extort money from my worst enemy."
I draw the line.
Yeah, but you see he draws the line continually and reiterates his... You know, and you see it at the end when he gets angry with Faye. But it's so, I mean, you see him, he turns on his charm. He's willing to take off his hat and make sure that they spell his name correctly. And yet there are certain things, there are certain lines that he just will not cross. And it seems to me like it is in that you can have the rakish, you know, rogue. You can have the guy who's, you know, sophisticated beyond his means, but you also have this guy who has this incredible code, however compromised it is by his choice of
professions.
This
character was sort of drawn by reacting to the classic private eye who wouldn't do divorce work or anything like that, when in fact I knew that successful private eyes did nothing but divorce work.
Right.
And yet I wanted to give him some underlying sense of morality that would respond with absolute horror.
And he's so protective of it. You know what I mean? That's the thing that makes him ultimately honorable in this completely compromised world.
Yeah. The magnitude of what Noah Cross is willing to do, which is absolutely ravage a community, destroy it, take land to make money on it, and basically rape the land and his daughter.
Yeah.
And that is, you know, World War II hadn't happened.
Yeah.
And that kind of evil was not something that he would be used to dealing with.
Right.
And I wanted to have that.
I'd love to point out, you know, again, it's not only the actors who are all, you know, the cast who's all coming together to do, you know, to do some of their best work forever, but also you have John Alonzo and you have Dick Silbert and you have Anthea Silbert. You have this incredibly cohesive world that is created for these actors. You know, the propping in this movie, that shaving kit that he takes out and he looks at, the business cards, the book here that he's going to find that he's seen Mulray open on the hood of the car. All of these things, the handwriting, we're going to see later on in the library, you know, when he tears the paper, all of these little visual cues, just the silver ashtray that's disappearing out of the top of the frame. It's all so effortless and doesn't draw attention to itself in that kind of sweaty, horrible period movie way. It just is. And I think that's, you know, what makes this movie so great.
Roman was someone who believed in the power of shoe leather. And that is willing to take his time with these little pieces of information that he was accruing. And since this is one of the few movies, maybe the only one I know for sure, where the point of view of the detective is never broken. Jack
right.
is in.
It's so rigorous.
That you need to rely on that. And it gives it a ballast that it wouldn't otherwise have.
Do you know where Mulray's having lunch?
No, I'm sorry, I don't.
Well, and here also, just the way that he deals with Hillerman here, I mean, obviously, you know, Nicholson is, you know, world class, but Hillerman is so good in this scene. He knows that things have become awkward because of this printed material in the newspaper.
What are you doing here?
Shut the water off. What's it to you?
How'd you find out about it? You don't drink it.
Even the way that he overhears this conversation here, the way that he watches Nicholson at the elevator. Of course, this is my favorite joke in the movie. Then you'd have to be able to read, which of course I use with studio executives all the time. And he's such a great thug. You know,
yes,
it's such a Mitchum kind of the short tie, you know, so that the belly kind of.
The rum running came from some account of the old Ringe estate in Malibu, where they actually used to drop the rum off there. And that was one of those many things that I came across.
And, of course, Hillerman plays the rum runner in, I guess it's a Paper Moon, right? He's the sheriff. Yeah, he's wonderful. He plays twins in Paper Moon. He plays a sheriff and a rum runner. And I think this is probably the most perfect example of a house
of the period?
Well, just, I mean, it's so L.A., but it's so exactly the kind of thing that somebody who's wealthy and tasteful, Pasadena, it's this foothill kind of dwelling that is, it's not ostentatious, and yet you know it's sprawling. It involves indoor-outdoor living. You know, you're going to see it later with the drinks and with the tea in the back, and of course, the tide pool.
This is a Pasadena location.
It is, yeah.
And again, he takes his time here so he could hear the squeaking of the chamois on the Packard behind you. And again, it's just one of those moments where it's a world in which you do hear sounds.
Yes. It should be pointed out that James Hong is...
It's terrific.
Oh, he's so good. He's always so good. And the frame, look at that frame of the half of the palm tree and then the guy squeaking with the chamois.
Yeah.
And this lacquered door. And again, this idea of the sort of split level, you know, the house that you enter and then you have to move up and up and up into its the different sort of echelons of its dwelling.
Those levels are wonderful. What I like is that the secret to the mystery that he is eventually going to uncover is right in front of his eyes almost at the very beginning.
Yeah, there it is.
And like Oedipus, you have the mystery in front of you. He had the mystery. He was the killer and didn't know it. And here, in a sense, all detective movies are surrogate retellings of the Oedipus tale.
Interesting.
That from the very beginning, you know, the hands that you look at all the time are a reminder of the killer, but he doesn't realize it until the end. And then, of course, he realizes he was blind and then it puts out his own eyes. And I guess you could make something out of the eyes in this movie. But we didn't. I wasn't thinking that. But as you point out, it was there.
Bad for glass.
Yeah, sure. Bad for the glass.
I love this kind of, I mean, I'm not going to call it racism, but there's a tinge of his particular sort of disdain for Chinatown in the way that he treats the gardener. And, you know, when he says, yes, bad for the glass. And of course, it's obviously a hint, a big hint of what's to come. But it's particularly... It does all sort of go back to this horrible experience that he's had at some point, you know, and he's always sort of struggling to get out of the moral morass that is Chinatown. And the fact that this is all going to, of course, you know, it's the same wherever you go. It's not just Chinatown. It's also happening in Pasadena at a completely different level.
Chinatown, ultimately, with all of its little sects, makes it impossible for the police to operate with any kind of efficiency, and so they just wisely lay off. It ultimately suggests the futility of good intentions. No matter what you do, you're going to be wrong.
Yeah.
Anyway, the point is I'm not in business to be loved, but I am in business. And believe me, Mrs. Mulray, whoever set your husband up set me up. L.A. is a small town. People talk. I'm just trying to make a living. I don't want to become a local joke.
Mr. Giddens, you've talked me into it. I'll drop the lawsuit.
What?
I said I'll drop the lawsuit.
This is a fantastic two-person sit-down yak-up. It is as good as it gets. And she almost, when she says, let's drop the whole thing, there's that moment where you just go... You could lose the audience. They could get ahead of this and go, well, that was too easy. And the fact that he so quickly pounces on that, and then we begin to peel back the layers of Evelyn's dysfunction. You know, you begin to sort of see as she starts to sort of quake and as her voice gets, sort of trembles. And the fact that he's so insistent upon, and in a weird way, the thing that I love about this is that he's almost trying to get rid of her to get to her husband. He really wants to just plead his case so that she will, of course, make the introduction or whatever, and then he can be done with her. And, of course, everything lies with her.
If very personal. It couldn't be more personal. Is it business or an obsession with you?
Let's look at it this way.
You know, it's kind of deliberately distracting that he's looking for, again, a mystery, that the solution to it that's right here, only he doesn't know it. It really goes back to the point where, initially, as strange as it sounds, I was worried about which to deal with first, the mystery of the water or dealing with the incest. And,
right.
Of course, it's obvious that the water had to come first.
Yes.
But it took a little thinking about.
You might try the Oak Pass or the Stone Canyon Reservoir frequently at lunch. Hollis takes walks around them. Otherwise, he'll be home by 6:30.
I'll stop by.
Please call first.
I love that she finally kind of puts him in his class at the end where she says, call first.
Yes.
You know, because it's and again, this is where I honestly feel no one but Faye can play this part, because the amount of whatever it is that's lying underneath this facade, the amount of pain and dysfunction is hinted at in this scene, and yet you know at the same time that she's trying to blow him off that they are going to continue to revolve around one another. You have this feeling that this is going to, we've not seen the end of this, even though she sent him on his way.
Well, that's good. I don't know that we were thinking about that.
She's doing some amazing, amazing shit here. And again, you know, this is the great, this is what makes Robert Towne great, is that the business cards that are pilfered from the office now become the keys to entry into the next scene. And this is one of those scenes, you know, the Escobar scene, this could be, you know, just a kind of dick measuring contest. And it isn't. It becomes all about, in the most terse way, it becomes all about the past and all about Chinatown and what it really means to be, you know, morally compromised.
It's a way of raising that mystery, just in the quality of their suits.
Yeah.
How'd you get past the guard?
Well, to tell you the truth, I lied a little.
You look like you've done well by yourself.
I get by.
Well, sometimes it takes a while for a man to find himself. Maybe you have.
Yeah, going through other people's dirty linen. Yeah.
When I first saw this movie, not being sophisticated enough to realize that, you know, one of them, even though he's a lieutenant now, is operating at a in a different tax bracket than Jake, you definitely get the idea that one of them is a pillar of society and the other one's more of a pariah.
Right. Yeah, that's true. The choice of a Latino or a Mexican here was deliberate, because there was a suggestion that when that dam broke, it was Mexicans that were killed. And at one point, there was actually some mention of that, that Escobar did not regret the death of Mulray.
There he is.
And I love that the discovery of the body, that you cap that scene with the body. It's so, you know, narratively shocking. You know, here's the guy that we're here to see. Oh, by the way, he turns up, he's not only dead, he's very dead.
Yes.
Mrs. Mulray.
And this was interesting, because I didn't realize what I was doing in this scene until I did it. When she says it comes as a complete shock to me that he did it, and he said, and then I realized, oh my God, she had to know. And I didn't realize until I was writing that he would have to say, but Mrs. Mulray, didn't you hire a detective?
Yeah.
And it worked out very nicely, but it's one of those moments that you don't necessarily plan as you're writing
But again, and this is where it becomes, for me, the defining Nicholson character, is that he so easily jumps to her rescue because it's the right thing to do, not only because, not only does it save his license as a private investigator, and not only does it compromise him if she's allowed to speak, but he also needs to know. It's not that he wants to know, it's that he needs to know. He needs to know what's going on before the cops get there, because you've given a narrative reason he can't. He doesn't want to lose his. He doesn't want to lose his livelihood. But by the same token, there's something greater than just being smart.
He doesn't want to be a fool.
Yes. And yet the next, in you know, 20 seconds from now, he's going to be ushering her out past the paparazzi, and he's going to take off his hat, and he's going to tell them how to spell his name. So it's that constant push-pull between somebody who will not be made to look foolish by bureaucrats, who doesn't mind playing whatever he needs to in the press because they're so beneath the game that's really going on, that he's willing to say two T's and an E.
There's that part of him that's a bit of a popinjay.
Yeah.
And I like that. And Jack had that in him.
Yeah.
He used to look in the mirror and say, look at my teardrop nostrils. He had a limited kind of vanity that way that was charming. You know?
Get it. Two T's and an E. Yeah.
Thank you for going along with me back there. I just didn't want to explain anything.
You know, her wonderful buying her way out. This is where her, and again, it's, she's solving the problem in the way that she knows how, and she's leaving when she feels comfortable to leave, and she leaves him behind. And there's another thing that's really interesting about this period and a choice that was made, I feel, in staying over Gittes's shoulder, is that you're allowed to do that in a weird way because of these hats.
Yes.
And the hats, because you can see when somebody tilts their head. It's like when you're not aware of some how people tilt their heads and what they're registering when they're not, when they don't have that brim. But when you're over somebody's shoulder and you can see the way that the brim moves, it's almost as though you can see their face without seeing their face. You get the attitude of their listening.
And Jack felt that hat was an integral part of his performance.
And it is. It's so.
He said it more than once.
Yeah, I mean, there's a reason that that's the poster.
And you'll notice in the background there's a little bit of Santa Anita and Seabiscuit, as there was in the as there was, because I that's just purely personal for me. It's my first childhood memory, and you'll hear Joe Hernandez talking about it.
Quite a character. Lately, he's been running one of the downtown storm drains.
The operative thing here is that Mulray drowned in a riverbed with 6 inches of water, or less. As he says, he's not going to drown in a damp riverbed, you know?
Yeah. I love the way that the coroner is not afraid to touch the guy's face and brush the stuff off his face and smoke a cigarette with the same hand that he was just touching your cadaver. It's like you go, these are people who deal with this stuff every day. Right. So it's lovely in the way that it's all sort of, you know, it's just part of this one shot that plays this whole scene out.
Yeah. And then, of course, he returns to the riverbed.
And Goldsmith really, this is where Goldsmith earns his keep, because he's able to take this piano thing that was before, with that ding, 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 ding thing that was happening under Mulray, it's now evolved into this, and nobody did this better. It's like that it becomes this sort of psychotic plinking, you know, and he did it in Alien, and he does it in, it's when the things become discordant, and all of a sudden you realize something's afoot. And it's very, very simple. The orchestration of it is very, it's so stunning. And that, you know, I really do feel this is his best work.
Own Your Own Building. That was a sign that was actually in that riverbed.
Really?
Yeah.
In 1974?
No, my God, no. 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 People did live down in that riverbed.
Howdy. You were riding out here the other day, weren't you? Speak English?
If you want to recognize a kid from 2 days ago, put him on a swayback horse.
And you won't forget.
Yeah. And, you know, the light is so beautiful, the questions are so succinct and so perfect in terms of leading you onto the mystery that it doesn't even matter that you can almost hear Howard Koch go, and horse go away. Like you can watch when he does the cue. It's like you know that somebody's standing right next to the matchbox going, and you're gone. You're out of here.
Good horse.
It is a good horse.
sort of flea-bitten coat. But it is amazing how much you're on his back, isn't it?
Yeah. Most people think of subjectivity as being the point of view of the character. And yet, by stepping 3 feet back from the point of view of the character, you actually create more subjectivity because you get to experience it at the same time that the person who's on screen experiences it.
That's true. And Jack actually has a really good back for this.
Yeah. Well, he has an amazing profile, you know, so when he turns and you just get a little bit of cheekbone and you get that nose, he looks amazing in this movie.
He does.
And possibly one of the motifs is the lost Florsheim shoe. You know, that's the other. He had a perfect set of something and now one of them. Now he's got one bare foot.
Yeah, and he's keenly aware of it, of the fact that it was, after all, a Florsheim shoe that was lost. You know, it wasn't just any shoe.
And Florsheim, that was a big deal, huh?
Oh,
those
yeah.
Those are like Prados.
Yeah. Well, yes, as a matter of fact, that's what it was. A Florsheim shoe was...
You can see in this over the shoulder that they've done a take because the
yes,
it's shiny in the gully. That's totally forgivable. And they did this in one take, which of course,
yeah, they did.
I hate just the notion of it. It's beautiful, beautifully operated, and
it really is.
Very simply staged.
And Jack's adroit physically. I mean.
Well, if you've ever tried to climb over cyclone fence in a suit, it's not easy to do.
No.
Son of a bitch.
Goddamn Florsheim shoe.
Great line.
Hold it there, kitty cat.
Did you know that Roman was going to play this?
No. I didn't know it until Roman told me.
That you were going to have a Polish thug?
I did not know it, and I don't remember. I think we added the line, where did you get the midget?
Yeah. And this is just a spectacular special effect. I remember when this movie came out, let's see, it was 75?
74.
So I was 12. I wasn't allowed to see this movie, especially because they... slit somebody's nose in it. But it was part of the, I remember the set of lobby cards. They were black and white lobby cards. And one of them was the knife up his nose.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and it was so, and everyone that I knew was, oh my God, you can't believe this movie. He sticks a knife up this guy and he actually slashes his nose. And I remember thinking, that's not possible that you can, and everyone that I talked to was convinced that this is, they actually slashed Jack Nicholson's nose. Okay, so let's talk about the slitting of the nostril, which is not, I don't think I'm going too far by saying it's the greatest running gag in movie history, because not only does it make him so pissed off in this scene, not only is he going to get to comment on, I like my nose, I like breathing through it, it's going to get them into bed.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's going to be the thing that, it's the most improbable of plot devices ever, because it's not only going to be the thing that kind of stokes his vengeance, but it's also going to be the thing that is always the most difficult thing. It's how do you get the lovers to, how do you get them into the sack? And who would have thought that stitches on a nostril could, you know, that over hydrogen peroxide, they could finally find one another.
It's one of those things that happens where you simply follow out the logic of what you've done. I remember thinking, what can I do? Slit an ear, slit, do this and that. And then there just seemed something horrible about opening up somebody's nose. And then I realized, of course, for a detective, that's the perfect kind of...
I'm a snoop, as he says.
A nosy guy, you know? And then Roman quite wisely... insisted, this is not going to be a wound from which he can recover.
Yes.
It's going to be through the movie. And once you realize that, you're going to exploit it in every way you can. Yeah, that was what was, you know, there was no quick recovery from it.
What's your address? Maybe we could talk this over.
No, Mr. Gittes. Just look in the obituary column of today's L.A. Post record.
The obituary column?
You'll find one of those people.
Now, let me ask you. So Ida Sessions says in this, that she's a working girl.
Mm-hmm.
Does she mean a working member of the Screen Actors Guild? Or does
she
mean a prostitute?
No, she does not. That's what she means.
I see.
She means that she's
a
working girl. A prostitute
with SAG card.
Yes.
Tom Collins, with lime, not lemon, please.
Tom Collins with lime.
I got your check in the mail.
Yes. As I said, I was very grateful.
Mrs. Mulray, I'm afraid that's not good enough.
I love the dialogue in this scene. I love the way that he deflects the issue of whether or not he needs more money. And you do get, because he has this giant bandage on his face, you do get that he's more personally invested than ever.
Yes. Originally in the script there was an addition to the scene where a woman comes up and berates him for having ruined her life by catching her in bed with somebody. I think it ended with, "My husband's so upset he lies in bed every night and sweats. How do you think that makes me feel?" Nicholson says, "Sweaty." And with that, she aims her purse at him. But it was a bit too much. But
it's a wonderful idea, and it's so elegantly and eloquently done at the end when he shows up at Burt Young's house and he meets the wife,
right,
who we've seen on all fours in the ivy at the beginning,
right,
and she has a black eye, and the way that she takes Jake in at that moment, it's like you just go, it's so priceless. And it's, you know, again, if you're paying attention,
it's a perfect bookend in that sense, to start it with the Burt and pay it off there, and anything else would have been distracting.
How did you find out?
My husband.
He told you? And you weren't the least bit upset?
I was grateful.
Mrs. Mulray, you'll have to explain that.
Why?
I love Faye's beginning to disclose the real story because it's so slick. And I love his badgering. But I especially love his use of métier because it's so, again, it's so Nicholson. It's so nice to have this one little thing that he just classes up the whole sentence.
Yeah,
with.
He's a parvenu, and he pretends to these little niceties.
Yeah,
because he is sensitive about his profession.
Yeah, you get the idea that at the same time that he is fascinated by it, he realizes that it's slumming.
Oh yeah.
And it also seems like it's the perfect place for him to exist, to use the skills that he has at being able to sort of see through people, and that he has this great understanding of you know, the baser needs of humanity, so that he never loses sight of that fact.
He is somebody who is just curious about everything. So he's always watching and always suspicious, which makes the final revelation all the more shocking. He doesn't get to it.
There's a beautiful thing that kind of harkens to the post-coital scene where she says, I don't see anyone for very long.
It's
difficult for me. It's such a, again, it goes to her dysfunction. It goes to the, and it's such a perfect way. And when she says it, it's so spectacular.
You must have had a reason to ask me that.
No, I'm just a snoop.
Oh, no, I have my own car. The Packard.
Wait a minute, Sonny.
I want to point out, this is one of my favorite locations in in Los Angeles. This is the Biltmore. This is the landing to the Biltmore.
That's absolutely
right. And there's a building right there on the corner that was built in like 1965 that you can see just beyond the parking, which is the, but you get this beautiful light where the light bounces off the Biltmore and then bounces these sort of sandstone buildings. And it's very, it's incredibly sumptuous.
The light in this scene is beautiful.
Well, and it's just one of those places. If you're there at this time of day, it's spectacular. We actually shot part of Fight Club is we shot in the ramp just below this. But I remember going there and going, this is in Chinatown, isn't it? And I love the way that he announces that he still thinks that she's hiding
something. Yeah.
It's such a great, it's just a way, and he feels he never feels like he has to sit there and explain. He's perfectly willing to walk out of a scene going, I'm watching you and I'm not buying any of your shit.
Mr. Gatches!
This was an interesting scene to write because so much of the backstory had to be gotten out, and it was done through that wonderful character actress's annoyance at get us sitting and insisting on waiting so we could.
And then, of course, she becomes, she can't stand his line of inquiry.
Right.
So she eventually goes, you know, it's more important that my boss deal with him than me have him around. I want to get rid of him so badly that I will arrange for him to meet the person that I'm entrusted with keeping from him. It's like she comes back she's coming out of this and he's like, tell him I'm not here. And she tries that. And then, of course, Nicholson just keeps going. And finally she just says, it's better that he be annoyed by this guy and that he be at risk than me. I mean, in a weird way, it's like the bureaucracy thing. It's like he's constantly up against bureaucracy. I mean, people and sleazebags and lowly criminals and adulterers, he can deal with that world, but the thing he cannot stand is bureaucracy.
Yes. And Hillerman just so wonderfully typifies that kind of glassy surface that you cannot get a purchase on.
Yeah, and he's not in the least bit unctuous. He's just, I know what my job is, and I know, he gives you no purchase.
Noah Cross worked for the water department.
Yes. No.
Well, did he or didn't he?
He owned it.
This is also just exquisitely propped. I mean, this whole thing. And we haven't even met Noah Cross yet, and it's such a great tee-up for who Noah Cross is, the photographs of Noah Cross as some kind of Hearstian, Howard Hughes kind of figure.
You know, it was important to get that information out in a way that the audience will remember before you meet Noah Cross.
Well, because you've seen Mulray, and Mulray is, I mean, in a weird way, and this is a credit to Houston because he has that wonderful voice, but he, by the time he's in this movie, he's a little frail. He's not a fearful, it's not like you have, it's not Bob Mitchum. He's like, he's not like a guy who's, I mean, Houston in his day was a fighter and boxer and all that, but by the time you meet him, he's a little long in the tooth by the time you meet him in the movie. It's in Seven where they're scratching on the door and they're painting out Morgan Freeman's name. I love the presentation where she's finally like, I would much rather have you be in here. And you can see on the walls where the paintings, the pictures have all moved. You can see the shadows on the walls in the background where Hollis's pictures have been taken down. And
yes.
Such a nice touch.
Well, Houston was really, I don't know anybody else that in a kind of grandfatherly, magnanimous way could suggest pure evil.
Interesting.
And without it, you'd be lost.
But I think the thing that ultimately, you know, because you have to build toward that bizarre sort of horse-like whinny that he does when he says, very few people have to ever deal with the fact that at a certain time and a place they're capable of anything yeah. in the way that he says it. There is this, he's not evil in that accomplished way. He's compromised by his, by things that are so base. And there's a real humanity that he has as a villain because you, he does, because he does seem sort of like a pathetic grandfather.
Yes. Yeah. But he doesn't hesitate to.
No.
I mean, his ruthlessness, in spite of the seeming frailty, is.
And that's what makes it feel like. That just makes it feel real instead of it being Darth Vader, instead of it being, you know, instead of it being a guy who is just evil throughout. He's a guy who did great things and then thought to exploit that which he had already built. I mean, one of the things that I think is so interesting about Hals Mulray is that by the time you figure out what it is that he was doing, you realize that he was sort of the last hope at decency and that he was murdered at his home. And there's something about you sort of miss him. The world as described is, it's not one, I mean, here's Hillerman is not an evil guy. He's just represents, he's part of a structure that supports people like Noah Cross and supports progress and all of those things that Noah Cross stands for. And yet there are innocent people who are going to be trampled, and that's simply okay with him. Or he may not even be aware.
There were innocent people. The whole, all of Bishop and the Owens Valley was sacrificed, as it happens, unnecessarily, because it was kept a secret so these guys could buy up that land and speculate on it without other people getting in on the speculation.
Right.
Which is why they kept it a secret.
I love when he opens that door and you see her waiting for him in his office. That's one of the most beautiful frames I've ever seen.
It is.
You look at it and you just go, and it's a trans light. It's like, you know, it's the beginning of trans light. So this is probably a giant black and white trans light that's been painted and tinted by hand. And it's 1974. But you look at it and you just go, it's just so stunning. And again, he's doing a thing here now. The eye lines are so wide. I mean, where Gittes is looking is so far off camera. Where she's looking, she's almost in profile. You're barely seeing the other eye. This is something that you would never do today. Everybody would, and it's a Polanski thing. You know, it's what he's comfortable with. But there's something about not being directly in the actor's eye line, which makes it feel realer. And the fact that they're so good, you know, and he's going to do this thing where. Right here where he says.
Did you get married before or after Mulray and your father sold the water department?
So he drops the bomb, and mm-hmm. now we're finally in her eye line. We've edged over like a foot and a half mm-hmm. from where we were. So now we're getting both beams of the headlights. And then she's going to go in this wonderful gag of having two cigarettes going. And how he watches her. I mean, you know, so little in movie making today is actors watching or existing with one another. It's like your time on camera is when you're yakking.
My talking about your father upset you?
Well, no.
I mean, all this stuff is happening off camera. This, my talking about your father upset you, is all she grinds out a cigarette. It's like you would, you know, that would never be tolerated. Well, the actor, you'd have to see the actor say that line.
Yeah, I guess so. You know, at the time, it seemed like the best way to deal with it.
Hollis felt that the water should belong to the public, and I don't.
And I love the way her eyes go up as she remembers what it is that Hollis used to say. It's so, you know, it does look like people who've lived together for so long. She kind of runs through her Rolodex of things that he used to say. Well, Hollis would say that the water belongs to the people, and there's that. It's such a nice little moment.
You sure about that?
This is a good-looking tag.
Yeah.
Because you almost forget it until the end of the upcoming scene with Cross.
The copy's for you.
Amazing use of LA. I love Catalina.
Yeah, me too.
And it's such a great, and then a terrific cue. You know, it's the most sinister music in the movie.
Right here.
Oh, yeah. The drive up in a Woody to meet Noah Cross is as scary as anything. It's scarier than the music that accompanies getting your nose cut off your face.
Now, this was a riff on the old Tuna Club, the Albacore Club.
Yeah.
The Tuna Club ran L.A. This location was actually Palos Verdes.
It was, okay.
Yeah, there was no suitable ranch on the island.
Albacore. I love the way that Noah's corrected gets.
Yes.
It's such a, again, it's such a, it's the kind of thing that somebody of that station just, it's like it doesn't really matter if you call a person by his name because you're just so fucking rich that you could.
Right. He never seems to get it right and doesn't care.
And the other thing that's amazing about this is that the actors are going to eat.
Yes.
Which you never see in movies because people think that it's unsavory or unattractive in some way. And here he is, the first thing John Huston's going to do is he's going to cut the head off that thing and he's going to start chewing on it. And they've got white wine and it's going to play out in one take. And here's Jack, he's game, and he starts sawing away and they start eating. And he's going to talk as he chews. And it's all these things that, you know, people try to avoid in movies at all costs.
Also, the length of this scene.
Yeah. The guy in the background who's just waiting to be of service at some later time, later moment. What is this, like 3 pages?
Oh, no.
More.
Oh, yeah, at least 5 or 6.
Wow. I love the way he daubs his bandage.
Disturbs me. It makes me think you're taking my daughter for a ride. Financially speaking, of course. What are you charging her?
My usual fee. What's the bonus if I get results?
Are you sleeping with her? Come, come, Mr. Gibbs. You don't have to think about that, remember, do you?
If you want an answer to that question, Mr. Cross, I'll put one of my men on the job. Good afternoon.
Mr. Gittes.
Gittes.
Gittes. You're dealing with a disturbed woman who just lost her husband. I don't want her taken advantage of. Sit down.
What for?
You may think you know what you're dealing with, but believe me, you don't. Why is that funny?
That's what the district attorney used to tell me in Chinatown.
Yeah? Was he right? Exactly what do you know about me? Sit down.
Mainly that you're rich and too respectable to want your name in the newspapers.
Of course I'm respectable. I'm old. Politicians, ugly buildings, and whores all get respectable if they last long enough. I'll double whatever your fee is and pay you $10,000.
All I remember about John Huston was I think he was married at one time to Evelyn Keyes.
Yes.
And he drove her crazy.
Wouldn't it be useful to talk to her?
Maybe.
Mulray was murdered. She'd be one of the last to have seen him alive.
When's the last time you saw Mulray?
Sheriff's gold posse. Bunch of damn fools to pay. $5,000 apiece towards the sheriff's re-election. I let him practice up out here.
Yeah.
It's such a great notion that this guy is dressed in this sort of Mexican, you know, this ranch garb that he has, you know, this sort of way that he sees himself is, it's not, you're right, I mean, he's not in a tuxedo, it's not in Hancock Park, it's not, I mean, it's such an odd, you know, notion of a millionaire.
And this is nice because the revelation that he knows that John Huston has seen Mulray.
Yeah.
Jack reveals it on his back, so we get to see Huston's reaction, which is about as close as we come to breaking a point of view.
Exactly. And the beauty of it is, of course, it comes off a direct reverse, which, of course, children don't try this at home. You never go from one side of a conversation to the other side where the two people change places. But in a weird way, by changing places and by occupying the space that the one occupied before, it allows you to have that moment you just described, which is we're now seeing something that Nicholson isn't seeing. And it's the only time, actually, that we see something that he isn't seeing.
Right. But because he's in the frame.
Yeah. It's okay. And you can actually see this, like, little kind of tilt of his head as he registers it.
Right.
And again, they're having lunch in a tackle room or something. Like, I don't know what this room is.
It's not technically a tackle room, but what it suggests is the horse is led with a halter up to here.
Yeah.
And there are bridles for certain horses.
But there's a love seat, and then there's, you know, I mean, and again, it's this California indoor-outdoor living. They're having lunch on a little veranda, and there's a love seat in the back.
Mm-hmm.
And a changing screen. I love this scene. And again, it's Jake Giddey's versus bureaucracy.
Right.
And the thing he cannot tolerate, which is...
officiousness.
it's just give him a good adulterer or a murderer. He just can't deal with the pimply Hall of Records guy.
Right. Yes, this is not a lending library. It's the Hall of Records.
And he so talks down to him that, of course, you're okay with the fact that he's destroying public property. How many times have you wanted to do that in a movie where a guy walks 8 feet down a thing and then finds exactly what it is that he's looking for and pulls it out? You would say, oh, no, he's going to have to read like 15, 20 of those things before he finds the right one. No, he doesn't. He can just go right down there. Jack Nicholson. And again, how beautiful the props are.
Yeah, they really are extraordinary.
Just seeing the tiny bit of that corner come up. You saw it in that first shot. Now you're seeing it again. All of these little handwritten, you know, with fountain pens.
Say, Sonny, why do they have all those names pasted in the plat books?
Land sales out of escrow are always recorded within the week.
And these are all new owners.
That's right.
And this is also, you know, the eye lines are kind of wide. The only time you go to a close-up is when he has some kind of realization, when he says, well, that means these things are sold. That's the only time you go to the close-up. Otherwise, the shot of the librarian is always the same size.
Mm-hmm.
It is dead simple storytelling. And that, it has to be because the complexity of the tale that's being told, you can't get into a lot of cutaways to this and cutaways to that. You don't want to bounce around a lot. You know, I look at the scenes that he has with Evelyn, you know, with Faye, and there are so many times where half of a scene plays out on one person's face with the other person off camera. And again, it's this dead, keeping it dead simple. I love the cutaway to the librarian, too, after he coughs. And it's one of those things you go, wah, wah, wah. It's a wah, wah, wah moment.
I remember there was an argument about whether it was to be 185 or 225.
Really?
Yes. And Roman was insistent on 225, and I think that dictated... a lot of the storytelling in a good way.
Yeah, because there's so much room for that bit of shoulder and the bit of the hat and the bit of the ear. You know, that it allows you to play all of that stuff with Jake in frame. You know, you get so much real estate around him to see what he's seeing.
Hold it right there!
I love this scene. Again, Now, when he says, you dumb Okie, is this...
Well, the Dust Bowl had already taken place.
So these are...
The Okies were coming out here. Yeah, absolutely.
And these are all the guys who are working the farms and...
Some of those guys were, yes. I mean, this guy...
So it's intended to be really what he thinks that guy is, or is he just being sort of generically...
He's being... I mean, he's just...
Snotty.
Snotty. He's being snotty. Because it was it was and had become by that time a deprecatory.
Yeah. This is spectacular. This shot here, and then the wheel comes off, and then into the tree is fantastic. And this next fight scene, which ends with Nicholson being hit on the back of the neck with a crutch, that's fantastically violent. Oh, I see. I just saw that the crutch is rubber.
Oh,
you can just, yeah, he's holding it at the point that it's, but it's fantastic. When he hits him on the neck, you look at it and you just go, wow, that really hurt.
I love Jack's attitude here.
I said, see if he's armed, then empty his pockets.
I love that he takes out his
handkerchief and wipes
and wipes the sweat off himself.
He ain't armed.
All right, mister. Who you with, the water department or the real estate office?
Get away from me.
Answer him.
You come near me with that thing again, you're going to need a pair of them.
Why don't you pick on somebody your own size?
I said, cut that out. Give the man a chance. Say something.
The name's Giddes. I'm a private investigator.
Now, is his nose bleeding? That's a fantastic touch.
Yeah. It had the blood in there. It is bleeding.
It's a great touch.
Irrigate my land. The water department's been sending you people out here to blow my water tanks. They put poison down three of my wells. I call that a funny way to irrigate. Who'd hire you for a thing like that?
I don't know what it is exactly that he shows. Is it the contract that...
Yes.
It is? Mm-hmm. And he has it on him.
Yes.
That's so funny. That really looks like a kick to the nuts.
Yeah.
But this where he hits him right here.
Oh, God.
It's fantastic. All in one shot. And you just go, wow. That looked like it hurt.
Yeah. It was really well staged.
That looks like Sounder, so this is not Cortez.
No, this is all.
And you were there, and you were there. I like that he has monogrammed. He has a monogrammed shirt.
And Thea made sure of that.
You didn't look too good. We thought we'd better call your employer.
I love the look on his face. It's so...
This is the other scene that Cortez shot.
Well, this is one of those scenes where you are just fucked because you know the sun's going to be changing all over the place. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, this is as close to Annie Leibovitz as any scene in any movie. I mean, it's a giant soft source that's on the hood of the car, and it's pushing a single source. It's pushing back. You can see he's casting a shadow on the lid of the... And it's going to be one of those things where if you get the right take, you're going to be done. But if not, the sun's going to go down. And... I've seen this scene 100 times. I cannot find anything wrong with it. It's like it just goes off like clockwork. Just the way that she, it's totally believable when she says, I think I would have remembered. You know, you kind of go, you know, it's not confusing. It doesn't make you feel that she's able to completely, you know, end that question that he might have about her being implicated in this. And it's just, and it's so beautiful. And I don't know where these hills are, but...
I don't remember, to tell you the truth.
It's fantastic, but that's what the valley looked like.
Yeah.
Way back when, then, my goodness. Unfortunately, this whole scene had to be looped.
Yes.
But they're still good. It's great.
Had to be looped outside the Biltmore, too. That scene was looped.
Yeah.
You Jack was know. Mad about that. Jeez.
Now, the Mar Vista, this is now the Archer School for girls. And that was one of the reasons I was actually interested in my daughter going there, because I just love this. I love this building so much.
It's a great
it's
building.
So fantastic. And I remember, and again, so many of the locations for this movie, I would just be driving through L.A. and I would give myself whiplash going, that's from Chinatown. That's from Chinatown. Now, I mean, this is a spectacular scene.
Hello there. I'm Mr. Palmer. Can I help you folks?
Yes, I hope so. It's Dad. I can't see.
Roman felt he was perfect for the part.
And the way that he covers his face and his hand trembles there, and he has no control over his blinks, you can tell that this guy's never been in front of a camera before.
Never.
And I love the anti-Semitism here. It's the perfect keys to the kingdom because you get it just shows how he's able to. It's like whatever
exploit,
the answer
whatever
is,
it is
that's what
it.
It's going to be.
Yeah. It reminds you of that time, and it also lets you know his ability to exploit it.
Well, he exploits it here, and then of course as he goes in later, and he says, "Well, I'd like to see the names," and he said, "I couldn't do that." Of course you couldn't. That's exactly the answer that I'm looking for. Do you mind if we have a look around?
That's exactly what I wanted to hear you say.
Good. I wonder, is it too late for us to have a look around?
No, allow me to show.
As an actor, when you get a script that has a scene like this in it, you have to just go. I mean, you have to be thanking your lucky stars that this is going to be, you know, I mean, because it is narrative and character absolutely wed. He's impressing her at the same time that
The little guy Goose is the nurse here.
Yeah.
And it's Roman. But it's also that kind of stuff would occur to me because it was Jack.
Yeah.
Because he would be funny doing that.
Yeah.
Other people would be like chalk across a blackboard, but with him, there's a kind of raffish charm.
But he's propping. This is just stellar propping.
Yeah.
Like all the. Now, this moment where she begins to understand what it is that he's putting together, when we slide past her face and we follow him as he walks out, and now he's starting to lay it out, and she's just as sort of more. I mean, coming from where she's, I mean, she knows that her father has murdered her husband, who is the most decent person in the whole movie. But she's beginning to see what the greater implications. Now she's beginning. And the fact that she's sort of emotionally embroiled at this point, the fact that she's interested in this old woman, you know, that Gittes has sort of pulled her into his drama, that she's watching this now, and there's something about this person from this very rarefied place who has never given a flying shit about these other people, and she's beginning to, this is what will allow us to care about her.
Yeah, with the Albacore Club taken in pieces there.
Yeah.
And about to be put together.
And I love how she tries to sort of interrupt him, but again, just like when he was telling his joke about the Chinaman, it's like he's just going to go one step too far, and she can't get his attention, even though she wants desperately to get him. And that's as interruptions go, as a facial tick interruption goes, I mean, you got to give it to Nicholson. That's as good as it gets. And then the 1,000-watt smile, and he's off. The pulling down of the jacket, is this a conscious homage to Maltese Falcon? And
no, it wasn't. It wasn't conscious, but I figured he had to do something with a big guy like that.
Yeah. I love the gel on the windows. That they've obviously gelled the windows for when there was an exterior, and they didn't have a chance to pull it off yet. And then they do between cuts.
Thank you.
So when he pulls this off, it's so Elisha Cook. I mean, it's so much more savage than what Bogart does to Elisha Cook Jr., but it's so...
Well, putting it over his face, I just felt was
yeah
really good, because you can only imagine what the hell happened to him.
A little overacting by the,
yeah,
by the extras, but yeah. They're octogenarians. You give it to them. Who's this guy? Who's the guy with Roman in this scene? He's a new thug.
I don't remember.
Thug number three.
I don't remember.
And the apartment building across the street from Archer is obviously like circa 1967. So yeah, we just don't light that side of the street. Now that is a... I love this. Him watching her as she daubs
her eye. Yes. And that's the eye that's eventually going to get it.
Oh, yeah. Oh, that's right. Yes, the eye at the end.
Maid's night off.
Why?
What do you mean, why? Nobody's here, that's why.
No, I gave everyone the night off.
Easy, it's an innocent question.
It's an innocent question, which is such a great... such a great tee-up of...
No question from you is innocent?
Yeah.
To you, Mrs. Mulray. Frankly, tonight you saved my... you saved my neck.
I love the notion. I love the idea that he's trying to kind of clean it up a little for a classy dame.
Yeah, that's true. He does that several times.
Yeah. She was cute in a cheap sort of way. Now, she was what, pretty? She was pretty in a cheap sort of way.
Of course.
Get through a whole day.
Actually, this hasn't happened to me for a long time.
When was the last time?
And again, Faye is... She never succumbs to, I mean, she's not a femme fatale. No. She is a woman of mystery, but the mystery never feels like, you never get the feeling that there's a bottom to it. You always get the feeling like, you almost don't want her to tell you what it is that's troubling her, because you in some way feel like it'll never end. You know, you see her... You know, she never plays anything obvious like, I mean, this is such an, do you have any peroxide, he asked. And then the way she takes his hand to carry him into the house, that's a beautiful little moment.
Yeah, and it's also, we wanted something that, there's something that seemed to me kind of perfect about the bathroom.
Yeah.
As a means of...
And the fact that, she's been expecting some little tiny thing, and she's now she realizes the cost of his interest in her whole dysfunctional world. It comes at, it's coming at such a great cost to him.
It's also, it was a good time to get the bandage off his face.
Yeah.
It
must be painful. What's wrong?
Your eye.
It's a nice moment of revelation.
I do think Goldsmith hit this a little early.
This moment?
Yeah. Right there.
Yeah. Well, then
it's like if it could have been right as she flicks his nose.
Yes. You're right.
If it would have been just... So she sees his lips, she looks at his lips, and then she does this little nose flick.
Mm-hmm.
Boom, if it had happened there. You would think saxophone, you would think violin, you would think something, but the trumpet is so, it can be no other movie than this.
Yeah, there's something, again, he just stuck with it.
Yeah.
It was great.
And this is the most beautifully lit shot in the movie. It's just astounding. And the fact that it ends with the unanswered question, dead?
Sometimes.
Must have looked cute in blue.
I mean, can you imagine the studio notes today? If you had a scene, a postcoital scene where they're smoking, first of all, they'd say, you got to take that out. Second of all, that when she asks her, cherchez la femme, And the look that he gives her is so fantastic. And it's leading to something that's so revelatory. And you want it so bad. And, of course, then she says, dead? And then the phone rings. We'd still be rewriting this script if you'd turned this in last year. We'd still be rewriting it because they'd be saying, you have to answer that. You have to answer that question.
One of the, not the least of Evans' benefits is that those questions stopped with Evans.
Yeah.
And Evans never asked the questions.
I think that's a tribute to his showmanship. I think that he had an understanding that the best questions can't be answered succinctly. And so if you can't answer it succinctly, it has no place in a movie. You know, if you can't, if it's a question that, I mean, movies require sort of chewable, they have to come in chewable bites. And the bigger the, it's spectacular.
Cherchez la femme. Was there a woman involved?
Of course.
Dead?
I love that. Dead, and then the phone rings.
Yeah, just enough to keep in your mind.
And to keep her connected to this.
But then you have to shift the whole question onto what this is about.
No, look, don't do anything. Don't do anything until I get there. I have to go.
I don't know if this is a choice. I don't know if this was in the text. When he mentions her father, that he saw her father, and she covers herself. It's such a... It's so spectacular. It is such a raw...
Trust me this much.
I mean, of course, when she says, trust me this much, in that way, you, of course, don't trust her at all. And then this incredibly manipulative kiss, which is meant to promise so much more, but the fact that she never lets her eyes off of him. She just continues to see if it's working. And then she goes... She just can't leave well enough alone, so she's going to divulge a little bit more. But this thing that happens when he says...
The Albacore Club.
Yes, it has to do with my father.
I know.
He owns it. You know?
I saw him.
You saw my father?
It's just... It's like... Whatever's going on in this household, it's like, it's not for the faint of heart. Like,
yeah, you know, it's not going to get better.
Yeah.
What did he say?
When you talk about fate, Dunaway, in this period, I mean the 74, so 67, 60, I guess Bonnie and Clyde is 68.
67.
So one of the two most beautiful women in the world, and yet with the plucked eyebrows and with the white skin and with the...
Marcelled hair.
Yeah, the tortured hair. She is unbelievably beautiful at the same time that she's just a little bit scary because it's so controlled. It's like, it's almost like it's the facial equivalent of bulimia.
Also, with that stark bone structure... there's something that's suggestive of a death's head at certain moments.
Even the death of your husband.
It's possible. Now, please, don't ask me any more questions now. Just wait for me here.
And the blinking. The thing about blinking is that it's indicative of a character's thought process. And I love the fact that this is a woman who is so not in control of her life and what it is that's going on, and yet she's constantly juggling, trying to juggle everything. And you just go, it's the tragedy of her. It's the thing that you know at some point she's going to have to reveal what it is that's going on, and you know that she's
And you're going to be waiting for it.
Yeah. Now this, his inventiveness, the processes, the lengths that he goes to in order to be able to follow her, where he breaks this light and the watches, all these kinds of things that were such great period ideas? Were these, did you read about this in crime fiction or?
I can tell you that one of them came from a cop of the period where I was asking him, I was just doing research and the guy paid him like $100 to come in and talk to me. He was a cop out of the 30s. I asked him how he followed people. He told me about the watches.
Huh.
So I used that. The same thing was true of the taillight. I said, how did you follow cars? And that was from somebody else.
Yeah. It's so great because it's so period and it's so direct. This is direction right here. When you see her and she pulls up, she drives clumsily up the driveway, she gets out of the car, takes for fucking ever. She goes across and you're mm-hmm. sitting there going, whose POV is this? And then the grill of the car comes in and then he walks away from it. And you just go, okay, in one shot, you've shown me a neighborhood of craftsman homes. I know that this is in, you know, Boyle Heights or you know, West Adams or someplace like that. This is not a Towne neighborhood. I know that this is, you know, I see this car. And now this is, for me, what Goldsmith does the best. And the beauty of this scene and his peering in and watching is you, it's also the over the shoulder. You're not hearing anything that he doesn't hear. You're not seeing anything that he doesn't see. The situation, because it's so beautifully constructed, is such that it only requires the actors to be realistic about the moment that they're portraying. They don't have to heighten anything. You have a teen girl who's obviously upset because she's just found out this horrible thing about her father, and you have her mother who's sort of keeping her, and you have this situation that's playing out, and it doesn't require any histrionics, but with that, those weird dissonant Goldsmith screeches.
They were wonderful. And also, it's nicely misleading.
Yeah, but it isn't misleading. It's simply his interpretation.
That's what I mean.
Yeah.
He's misled by it.
It's Lars Thorwald with his suitcase in the middle of the night, except, of course, that it isn't what it seems. Yeah. And this beautiful moment where you see him in the rearview mirror, and then she sits into the car, and the camera pulls back, and
give me the keys.
And again, it's so Nicholson and so Giddes in his, oh, come on, Mrs. Moore, like, you got your husband's girlfriend locked up in there. It's like the way that he says it. It's like it's so, you know. This requires some sort of intervention beyond me. I'm going to give you the chance to come clean on this thing because I am curious as to what it is that I've been chasing this whole time. But this is your chance. And you do feel like there's something so, it's his, the casualness with which he's willing to let all of the possible ugliness now be laid out for him. You know, he's not grabbing her by the lapel saying, you lied to me. He's saying, oh, come on, Mrs. Mulray.
Give me a break.
She knows more than you want her to tell.
You're insane.
Just tell me the truth. I'm not the police. I don't care what you've done. I don't want to hurt you.
You won't go to the police if I tell you.
I will if you don't.
And that, for me, is Jake Giddes. You won't go to the police. I will if you don't.
Yeah.
It's like I haven't made up my mind about the ultimate, but in the interim, yeah, absolutely, I'm gonna do whatever. I'm gonna step on your nuts. Was that in the script where she puts her head against the horn?
I think it was.
Yeah. It's fantastic. And again, she's so nervous. She's trying so hard to keep this secret. She's trying to keep Pandora's box locked.
I'm not positive about the horn, but I think it was. I mean, everything was pretty well spelled out, you know, in that way.
I would never have harmed Hollis. He was the most gentle, decent man imaginable.
Roman, I suspect, is like you in the sense that, you know, and he works it out.
Yeah.
And when we do it, that's it.
Yeah, it's so well worked out. But it's coming, again, you know, you rarely have a blueprint like this to work with, which is every single intent is here to be mined. You know, it's so, it's not confusing, and yet it's so complicated. And then, of course, when it unravels and it's made and light is shed upon it, you go, of course, it all works.
That's not what I meant.
I'd have reshot that scene.
I'd
have gotten her into a half light somehow. Now, again, this is where Faye Dunaway is. I just can't imagine anybody else in it when she says,
that's not what I meant.
When she says, that's not what I meant. And you can see that she is now projecting the father that's become the husband that's lost now, onto the stranger who takes an interest. And you can see how, I mean, what incredible damaged goods she is.
Yes.
This is a Dick Silbert masterpiece, and this is such a, I mean, this could be from Carnal Knowledge, or this is, I mean, the sliver with the light, the sliver of the door open with the light coming, and a bed, and the choice of the tones in here, the browns, and the...
After all this, then the phone rings.
Yeah, exactly. Just when you finally get to bed. I love how long it takes to answer.
And that's Roman.
Geddes? Geddes?
Yeah?
Ida Sessions wants to see you.
Who?
Ida Sessions. You remember Ida?
And of course, with Roman, I remember Roman. I'm almost sure it was Roman who said, have him call back.
I'll tell you what. Ida wants to see me.
Yeah. Once you have their interest.
And then somebody hangs up.
Once you get them to take the other end of the taffy, you just keep pulling.
Yeah, that's right. So it'll take the time to do this and then have them call back.
Well, and it's also, I mean, it doesn't hurt that you've got that face to wait
on. Yeah.
Wait on. Now, the Sessions bungalow, which we're about to go to, this is, I haven't yet to find that. I'm sure it's been torn down. It was probably torn down in the 80s or something, made way for a mini mall. But I've looked for this bungalow. I found the El Macondo, but I...
The El Macondo is...
on Fountain, just off of...
It's on Sweetser.
Sweetser and Fountain.
Sweetser and Fountain. It was Conrad Hall's apartment where he lived. And this was in downtown L.A., and I'm trying to remember the street.
I've looked for this. I've never found it. But that is... And
perfect.
Just, and the single palm tree that's just shed everything and the wires going through. And this house probably is actually a post-war house on the left. It's not a clapboard. But this is just... It's so... It's such a great silhouette. You know, not only do you have the bungalow doors and this repeating pattern, but then that hat. And then, of course, he's standing here like any good cop, just knocking on it, looking at the broken.
Yeah.
I'm sure Howard Koch is right behind this door, just opening this door, because you can see it loses its momentum, and then it opens just a little bit more to let the camera operator through. This is an actual place. There's no way. It's too perfect.
No, it is a location.
It's fantastic. And again, the use of handheld here is exactly right. It doesn't feel, you know, this is like, you know, it's like Ridley's work in Alien. You know, it's so much about being, about taking in the surroundings with your hero. E.T. has a fairly terrifying head of lettuce when the kid comes down the stairs. But I think this is the most terrifying head of lettuce in the history of cinema.
and the melted ice cream.
Yeah. And of course, it tells you how long she's been there. It tells you the whole sad tale in one picture. And I love the way that he just takes it in like, somebody's trying to set me up. Somebody's, I mean, he never panics. And then here's that insert that I love, which is
her
Screen Actors Guild. I love the $2 bill. That's fantastic.
Those old operators' licenses.
Yeah. Social Security, Screen Actors Guild. Ah, the tragedy of Hollywood. And the sting happens early, which is odd.
It does happen again.
Why? It's so weird. It's like he goes in early on the love theme, goes in early on the seduction, but he goes in too early on the seduction, and here the light comes on too late, it seems to me. Now, this is a great... The dialogue that happens here as they position Giddes, and they got him. And then the way that he's just a moving target. They're boxing a shadow.
Nope, your wife got excited. She crossed her legs a little too quick. You understand what I mean, pal?
And again, the little lunge in with the camera to be in the middle of this. But this is my favorite thing. This is with Escobar here. When he gets his ire up, because Escobar, again,
accuses him
of something that's... Now, there's the only zoom that I can find. I guess there's a zoom in the first scene where they pull out from the photographs.
Yeah, I took them. So what?
And I love the way he comes clean. Yeah, I took him. So what?
You must really think I'm stupid, don't you, Giddes? I don't think about it that much, but give me a day or two and I'll get back to you. Now I'd like to go home.
I want the other pictures, Giddes.
And it's funny how, you know, there are so many scenes in movies, you see this a lot in Hitchcock, where somebody has to appear to have been involved with something, and yet... And they make a case for themselves. And, you know, as to, you know, Cary Grant makes a case for himself. I was here last night and I was doing this. And the people around him don't believe him. And in this situation, Escobar doesn't believe him. But he's not going to stand up for himself at all. He's going to walk home and go back to bed. And we've been with him, so we know that he's perfectly capable of doing that. And then Escobar transgresses the unwritten law.
Yes.
You're dumber than you think I think you are.
You're dumber than you think I think you are.
Escobar, that's where I draw the line.
I want the rest of the pictures, Giddes. We're talking about accessory after the fact, conspiracy and extortion, minimum.
What do you think? Evelyn Mulray knocked off her husband in the ocean, then dragged him up to a reservoir because she thought it would look more like an accident? Mulray was murdered and moved because somebody didn't want his body found in the ocean.
Why is that?
He found out they were dumping water there. That's what they were trying to cover up.
And again, the thing that makes it as revolutionary as it is that it's all about water.
Come on, Lou, you're in charge. Make a decision.
Now, that is his problem with bureaucracy. And you're going to see it, and the bureaucracy is about to get back at him. You know, I just talked to, what's Hillerman's? I just talked to...
Yelburton.
I just talked to Yelburton, and he said, now Giddes knows this, that there is some runoff, and this is the way bureaucracies get back at the man, you know, at the heroic character.
Yelburton, he's the new chief.
Yeah, I know who he is. Go on.
He said...
I know what he said.
I love he anticipates. I love how Giddes anticipates that Yelburton's sold him out. And I love the fact that it's so much, you know, it's so much about Giddes' inability to deal with bureaucracies. He doesn't respect them. He doesn't want to have anything to do with them. Come on, Lou, make a decision.
Wants to hang on to his little gold bar.
Have your client in my office in 2 hours.
And this is smart. It's not a This is like a real, that's a real threat. It's not movie detective fiction where you kind of, where you're going, oh, okay, that's one of those idle, hollow threats. That's a real threat.
It was interesting, this problem of the salt water. You needed one additional step, and that was really responsible for creating the saltwater pond.
Yeah.
Because of the salt water in the lungs, and you didn't want it to be a simple case of being found in the ocean or even at the reservoir. You needed that additional surprising step, and it created the tide pool speech.
Yes.
Where's Mrs. Paul Ray? These her bags?
Now, again, I love the strings coming in here, this like low kind of humming thing that's going on as he's, you know, that it's a little bit ahead of the audience, but it's nice because it's such a beautiful image. And he's, and this is a thing I once talked to Dick Silbert about. He was telling me, and he was dedicated to this idea that you only have symmetry before something earth-shattering happens. So, you know, he would, like in Carnal Knowledge, he would have, you know, there's a suicide that takes place after you sort of set up the idea that everything's okay and then something bad can happen. So in that, you have this beautiful image of this woman in this beautiful house and this doorway in the center of the frame, and then all of a sudden, here come the strings. And again, this is just a great, I mean, there's no way to prove that it's salt water, but the fact that he tastes it is so, it's, I mean, it's not as though it's any clearer to the audience that it's salt water, but the fact that he goes to that effort to do it because he needs to know.
Right there. There.
And again, he lets the gardener go and get it for him.
Do it. And this tells him, or so he thinks, that
Evelyn has been part of
the murder. But also, it tells him that Mulray was murdered in that pond. But he's not really right, because they weren't Mulray's glasses.
Yes.
That was the final thing that we needed to...
Yes.
He didn't wear bifocals.
So the nice thing is, of course, that the audience is now with where Jake is, and we go, oh, okay, he was murdered in that pond, and then, of course, the bifocals are the icing on the cake.
You wait.
And I love how pissed off he is. He has finally lost his shit. He is ready to talk to her, and the way she plays with these pearls, the incessant playing with the pearls and how are they going to be presented, and then the hair, and she is working him big time now.
Upstairs, why?
I want to see her.
She's having a bath right now. Why do you want to see her?
And of course, you don't believe her that she's having a bath, and it turns out to be true.
Yeah, yes, you don't believe
anything she's saying now.
Now you believe she's the villain, or you suspect it.
Yes.
Strong. And, of course, there were always the women with the black widows in these stories. And it was working against that convention by creating a neurotic heroine, really.
Look, what's the matter? What's wrong? I told you, we have a 5:30...
You're going to miss your train.
The light in this scene is amazing. And there's an actual problem with it later on that obviously they were... where the camera begins to throw a shadow on Nicholson as he's gets more and more pissed off. But it's nice because his face goes into darkness. It's like a cloud comes over him. Now, good. He's going to sit on this couch. He's going to take out a cigarette, and we're going to play this whole thing on her elbow. There's nothing until he's going to, no cutaway to the, it's like, here it is. I'm going to lay it all out for you. And now,
I found these in your backyard in the pond. They belonged to your husband, didn't they?
dink, and that's the first time. Yeah. I mean, you can never do that. In modern cinema, you'd have to watch her as he unrolled it. You'd have to pan with the thing as he, and now he's starting to get pissed off, and he's going to step around, and he's actually going to step into the shadow of the camera right here, right there.
Mm-hmm.
And he's been told, stay back on that one.
Yeah.
But they've got, you can see the camera shadow. And as he inches forward, he's going to continue to go into it, which is so nice because it's just, it's like he doesn't want to descend into darkness. He doesn't want to.
Yeah, that's right.
And now there it is. And he can't get out of it. And he keeps leaning to his right, trying to get, but of course, every time they pan, they shadow him a little bit more. And I'm sure there's a take where he was lit properly, but it probably wasn't as good as this.
Who is she? And don't give me that crap about your sister because you don't have a sister.
I'll tell you.
And now the slap.
I'll tell you the truth.
Good. What's her name?
Catherine.
Catherine who?
She's my daughter.
This is movie violence as good as it gets. Because
my sister.
It is literally changing her performance.
My sister, my daughter.
She gets knocked silly in this scene.
And, yeah, she
and,
does.
And when he pushes her to the ground, you have witnessed something between two people that is not, you're not meant to be given access to.
For God's sake, keep her upstairs. Go back.
And again, the wide eye line. She's here and she's going to look up and way to the right because she can't face him. You're not in the eye line. You're not up with him. You're not looking at it. You are omniscient and you are seeing a revelation. And it's so, the psychology of it is so, and it's too, they're both on the same side of the frame. She's short-sighted. She's looking off to the camera and he's short-sighted on the same side. So he has all the space in front of him and she has no space in front of her. She has been trapped. He represents the right side of the frame and he is literally crowding her and she must now tell him. And the psychology of that is so brilliant.
It may seem elemental now, but getting the revelation out by force, by beating the shit out of her was makes you believe that what she's saying is so.
This and slitting a guy's nose was everybody. You know, I remember Clute, everybody talked about her stabbing him with scissors. It was like in this period of time, in the early 70s and mid 70s, this was just unheard of.
I was 15. I wanted to, but
the rawness of this kind of emotional and incest, I mean, it was the, you know, I remember people who were uncomfortable with it making fun of the, it's my sister, it's my daughter, my mother, it's my, and yet nothing takes away from the power of this. And then, of course, he steps in.
Well, you can't take the train, Escobar. I'll be looking for you everywhere.
The beauty of it is that he then takes over, as we know, only he can. He has been activated.
He'll try and make it better.
How about a plane?
No, that's worse. You better just get out of here.
I mean, just the look on his face. He realizes she's not the monster. There's another monster.
Get the exact address.
I was watching it over the weekend, and this scene to me, when Nicholson finally intervenes on her behalf and you see his mind, his great mind, his political mind, his starting to work on her behalf, and you, to me it was heartbreaking. It was like to finally see Jake be involved in a personal way. The stakes had changed, that he finally saw her as a victim. And he finally sort of realized
where the bifocals come from.
Well, even before the bifocals, when he finally says, here's what we're going to do. You're going to do this. You're going to pack up your stuff. You're going to send it here. It's when you realize that he's in it, not because he doesn't want to be duped anymore, but once he realizes the depths of depravity that he
has uncovered.
Yeah, that he, it's so, and of course, then she delivers the information about the bifocals. And then she goes and introduces her daughter, which could be seen as a manipulation, you know, a kind of, and at the same time, it's so innocent, you know, that she sort of reveals what the stakes are to her, and that they are, that this tragedy is generational. It's now clouded three generations of the crosses. And he has kind of this opportunity to sort of change the way this whole thing turns out. And in a weird way, he becomes, to me, at this moment in time, he becomes as honorable as Mulray. He becomes the person who steps in and says, you know, yes, these are damaged people, and yet there's a chance that this can end here. And of course, that's the thing that ultimately becomes, you know, heartbreaking at the end.
Yeah, well, he's convinced, and rightly so, that all she's trying to do is protect this little girl.
Yeah, yeah.
And he responds to that. I love the fact that these two guys come in from the side of the frame.
Yeah. They're like... they don't have their guns drawn, but they almost have their guns drawn. And again, these are actors who would later on go on different episodes of Mannix and Magnum P.I. And yet there's this moment in time where they had a chance to be part of something that was... that is truly timeless, that is a classic, and they totally step up. They're
perfect for it.
Yeah.
You're going to stay there until she does show up.
Gee, Lou, I'm doing the best I can.
Gee, Lou, I'm doing the best I can. Yeah. It's like when he plays silly stupid, it's as entertaining as when he is so much smarter than everyone else in the scene.
Skipped the little lady.
Lou, can I ask you a favor? I'd like to bring her out myself.
Now, you don't anticipate what's going to happen here as an audience member, do you?
I didn't. I mean, you know, I await it gleefully because I love the wife and I love the shiner and I love his, you know Mr. Giddy. And then, of course, he can't even finish with the thought. No, I remember the first time I watched it, I was like going, what is he going to do? Whose house is this? What's happened, and why is he, you know, he's somehow screwed the pooch here. He's fucked this up, and he's brought these guys, and perhaps he's contemplated betraying her, and you're kind of going, oh, no.
Yeah?
And we don't know who she is.
No.
And then Burt Young, who is as good as he has ever been. Yeah. I'd like you to join us.
The thing that's nice about it, I guess, is that in spite of all of his cleverness of being just one step ahead, when he steps into it, in the end, he's no match.
Yeah.
It's just the whole thing is obliterated.
Well, it's the crushing reality of life, you know.
Yeah.
You can control elements of the chaos or you can spin them, but eventually, you know.
You're caught in the machine.
Yeah, and you're crushed by it.
It's the Cocteau's infernal machine. It's fate.
And it's so nice to see Burt Young again, and it's so nice to realize that he's gonna get out of this somehow. And when he puts his head down and has to, and Burt Young is at in the beginning, he's kind of happy to be part of a bigger conspiracy or a way out, you know. And then
are you sure this is all right?
Yeah. Then he's not quite so sure. He definitely doesn't want to be. He doesn't want to do any hard time.
By taking a couple of passengers to Ensenada, you'd have to leave tonight.
I don't know.
And I love how the price keeps going up.
Yeah.
And it's such a nice thing, you know, the scene with Sophie at the beginning where they come out of the office and you don't really know what the conversation is,
right.
But forget it, Carl. I don't want to take your last dollar. Like, you know, that's not the kind of guy I am. But you know that he, of course, was saying to him in the office before they enter, hey, man, you do owe me.
Right.
You owe me a lot of money for this. I normally make a lot of money for this. And then, of course, he holds it out to the end of the movie, and it bookends the movie.
It also reminds you that he's an axis that allows him to go down all these mean streets.
Yes.
And meet every segment of society.
Yeah. Which, of course, is the thing that allows him to be as good. It allows him his redemption. You know, the fact that he's not hobnobbing in the back room with the Noah Crosses and the Hollis Mulrays, that he's looking out for the common guy on the street because he's as smart as the guys in the back room, but you know.
In the end, not as venal.
Yeah, incapable of the venality.
I've got the girl.
You've got her? Where?
Do you remember the figures we discussed?
Of course I do. Where are you?
At your daughter's house. How soon can you get here?
And I love the fact that, of course, he says, he brings up the, do you remember the figures, which, of course, is, it tips Noah Cross off to the fact that this is a guy who can be bought.
Yeah. Yeah, he plays that just right.
And there's a 5K just out of the scene right there that's painting that wall. You can kind of see the shadows of the barn doors there.
Oh, yeah.
Truly bad.
Oh, there you are. Well. You don't look too much the worse for wear, Mr. Gitz, I must say.
He's so happy. It's finally all kind of come together, and he's going to get what he wants, which is what he's used to.
Where is she?
With her mother. Got something I'd like to show you, Mr. Cross.
And again, this is the genius of this movie, which is the speech about how much more can you have? How much more can you own? What can you eat that you can't afford now? And he really is just doing this all for the... I love that he's handed him the clipping just for the glasses.
That you killed Hollis Mulray. Right here. In that pond. You drowned him. And you left these. Coroner's report shows Mulray had salt water in his lungs.
Now, when you presented this script to Nicholson, did he leap at the chance to play him? Did he see how immaculately tailored it was for him, or was he just, you know what I mean? Was there ever discussion about, oh my God, Robert?
No, he knew it, and he just accepted it. I had done the last detail and written it for him, and he just assumed, you know, after 7 years together in an acting class, my watching him, he figured I'd write it for him.
Right.
And we had a great trust in each other. And, yeah, he didn't love it. It didn't come as he expected to.
Yeah.
Tuesday, there'll be $8 million to build an aqueduct and a reservoir. I'm doing it.
Going to be a lot of irate citizens when they find out that they're paying for water that they're not going to get.
Oh, that's all taken care of. See, Mr. Gitz.
And that actually is the frame. You can tell this is what they used. This is the image that they used for the poster.
Yes.
Because you can tell the edge lighting. It's nowhere else in the movie is it coming from low and to the right, because you can see his nose casts a shadow up under his eye there instead of, and it's the, they took this moment, this was the thing that they created the poster artwork from.
Jim Pearsall did, yeah.
Yeah.
Now where's the girl? I want the only daughter I've got left. As you found out, Evelyn was lost to me a long time ago.
And Houston is so unbelievably twisted in the way that he phrases that. She has lost to me.
To face the fact that the right time and the right place, they're capable of anything.
And that anything is just, it is as disgusting a phrase
as there is.
Yeah.
Yeah. I didn't know where, I was going with this scene until I wrote the future.
It can't be anything but that. He has to see himself as a forward-thinking, entrepreneurial, you know, gifter of the, you know, he's gifting the San Fernando Valley all of this water. He's gifting Los Angeles all of this. Of course, he's going to take a vig.
the money they made.
Yeah. So the ending in Chinatown...
You know, I initially objected to it.
Yes. and it's the cause of much discussion. I agree with you that the ultimate would be never to have to go to Chinatown, that Chinatown is not a place you can actually go to because it's a state of mind.
You remember Night Train Claude Mulvihill, don't you, boys? Mr. Cross, these are my associates, Mr. Walsh and Mr.
I love how how Nicholson finds out that
too little, too late.
Yeah, and then how he offers his mitt to be, it's kind of like he's taken it as far as he possibly can. And now when he's going to go back in to explain what's going on, and there it is, the bureaucracy over his shoulder, who is going to get away with it all, and the smug smile that Houston has.
You shut up, I'm going to lock you into the wheel of that car.
Lieutenant, I am rich, I am Noah Cross. Evelyn Mulray is my...
He's crazy, Lou! He killed Mulray because of the water thing.
And now, for the first time, we see Gittes lose his cool. Yeah. He loses his shit because he's beginning to see the elements...
Heading, yeah.
Yeah, the elements that are at play that are bigger than him.
Then he doesn't have a chance in the end.
Your grand...
Come, miss.
Your grand...
And it's so creepy the way that Houston leans into the girl's face and tries to kind of make sense of it. But you can imagine this odd, leering man, stranger on the street coming in.
Come to my...
Get away!
And then, of course, she's, you know, Catherine takes her cue from Evelyn and her distress.
My God, she's mine, too.
And in the how many years have I got, you really do begin to imagine that this is somehow about his immortality in a way that the water can't be. You know, that all the stuff that they've done for the valley, that won't reflect on him, won't give him his immortality in the way that knowing this girl will. And it's the best being shot ever in a movie.
Yeah, it is great.
It's just a grimace. You don't see, he just looks incredibly uncomfortable. There's no way that shot hits her in the eye at that distance with that gun, by the way.
No.
Not a chance at 38 snub nose.
No.
I don't even think you could hit, you couldn't hit the lit building from that.
Not a chance.
But it's Chinatown.
It's County, yeah.
And our final flawed twins.
Yes. Here it comes.
Captain, get an ambulance.
No.
Turn them loose. Turn them all loose.
And I love how Lou just goes, let's just sweep this under the rug.
Right.
We know what to do in this. And I love Houston when he grabs and he puts his hand over her
that's
eyes.
That's a horrible image, that when he puts his hands over her eyes.
And the way that he's so simian, you know, there's something so kind of like an orangutan, the way that he puts his... Chimpanzee.
Yes. It is.
And that's some fucking great makeup that stitches on his nose. What's that? And Crispin Glover's dad, looking about as pained as... It's great faces. What a great foreshot. And how often do you see a foreshot where it's still top of the hats to the neckties, you know? It's like a close-up on four people.
And everybody's more or less in focus.
I'm doing you a favor. Come on, Jake. Forget it, Jake. It's Chinatown.
And
there you have it.
The line for all eternity. Now, I had to redone this last shot just because I think that the people are looking a little
like extras.
Yeah. I had done like 35 takes of this so that they were pretty bored with it by the time.
Right.
And this is in Chinatown? I guess so. I guess it's like...
It's either in Chinatown or on the edge of it.
I think it's Alvera Street, isn't it? Or Alameda?
I thought it was in Chinatown. Because there isn't much of a Chinatown.
Yeah. No, Chinatown's probably a block and a half. That probably is it. In 1974. And so You screen this movie the first time, and this plays out.
Yes.
And the lights come up in the screening room, and does Evans take a victory lap, or is he going?
No, nobody. We were just putting it together at the last minute, and that's the first time I saw the credits. And Art Murphy and this other kid who was the reporter, it came up, and I remember thinking it was the first time I'd seen it all put together, and I thought very clearly, maybe we'll get away with it. I promise you, I didn't think any more than that. And then this kid who was writing for a reporter said, I'm not supposed to do this, but he came up to me and said, but I've just never seen anything like it. And he went on and on and on. I thought, well, this guy's nuts, but, you know, so what? And Murph just left.
Yeah.
They were both great reviews, Reporter and Variety. But it was the first inkling I had anywhere that maybe we had a good movie.